Aesop's Fables, as told by Aesop in 6th century BC, ancient Greece. Translated by George Filer Townsend. The Ass and His Masters. An ass belonging to an herb seller, who gave him too little food and too much work, made a petition to Jupiter to be released from his present service and provided with another master. Jupiter, after warning him that he would repent his request, caused him to be sold to a tile maker. Shortly afterwards, finding that he had heavier loads to carry and harder work in the brick field, he petitioned for another change of master. Jupiter, telling him that it would be the last time that he would grant his request, ordained that he be sold to a tanner. The ass found that he had fallen into worse hands, and noting his master's occupation, said, groaning, "Oh, it would have been better for me to have been starved by the one, or to have been overworked by the other of my former masters, than to have been bought by my present owner, who will, even after I am dead, tan my hide and make me useful to him." The Fisherman and the Little Fish. A fisherman who lived on the produce of his nets one day caught a single small fish as the result of his day's labor. The fish, panting convulsively, thus entreated for his life. "Oh, sir, what good can I be to you, and how little am I worth? I am not yet come to my full size. Pray spare my life and put me back into the sea. I shall soon become a large fish fit for the tables of the rich, and then you can catch me again and make a handsome profit of me." The fisherman replied, "I should indeed be a very simple fellow if, for the chance of a greater uncertain profit, I were to forego my present certain gain." The Hunter and the Woodsman. A hunter, not very bold, was searching for the tracks of a lion. He asked a man felling oaks in the forest if he had seen any marks of his footsteps or knew where his lair was. "I will," said the man, "at once show you the lion himself." The hunter, turning very pale and chattering with his teeth from fear, replied, "No, thank you. I did not ask that. It is his track only I am in search of, not the lion himself." The hero is brave in deeds as well as words. The Wild Boar and the Fox. A wild boar stood under a tree and rubbed his tusks against the trunk. A fox, passing by, asked him why he thus sharpened his teeth when there was no danger threatening from either huntsman or hound. He replied, "I do it advisedly, for it would never do to have to sharpen my weapons just at the time I ought to be using them." The Lion in a Farmyard. A lion entered a farmyard. The farmer, wishing to catch him, shut the gate. When the lion found that he could not escape, he flew upon the sheep and killed them, and then attacked the oxen. The farmer, beginning to be alarmed for his own safety, opened the gate and released the lion. On his departure, the farmer grievously lamented the destruction of his sheep and oxen, but his wife, who had been a spectator to all that took place, said, "On my word, you are rightly served. For how could you for a moment think of shutting up a lion along with you in your farmyard, when you know that you shake in your shoes if you only hear his roar in the distance?" Mercury and the Sculptor. Mercury once determined to learn in what esteem he was held among mortals. For this purpose he assumed the character of a man, and visited in this disguise a sculptor's studio. Having looked at various statues, he demanded the price of two figures of Jupiter and Juno. When the sum at which they were valued was named, he pointed to a figure of himself, saying to the sculptor, "You will certainly want much more for this, as it is the statue of the messenger of the gods, and author of all your gain." The sculptor replied, "Well, if you will buy these, I'll fling you that into the bargain." The Swan and the Goose. A certain rich man bought in the market a goose and a swan. He fed the one for his table and kept the other for the sake of its song. When the time came for killing the goose, the cook went to get him at night, when it was dark, and he was not able to distinguish one bird from the other. By mistake he caught the swan instead of the goose. The swan, threatened with death, burst forth into song and thus made himself known by his voice, and preserved his life by his melody. The Swollen Fox. A very hungry fox, seeing some bread and meat left by shepherds in the hollow of an oak, crept into the hole and made a hearty meal. When he was finished, he was so full that he was not able to get out, and began to groan and lament his fate. Another fox, passing by, heard his cries, and coming up inquired the cause of his complaining. On learning what had happened, he said to him, "Ah, you will have to remain there, my friend, until you become such as you were when you crept in, and then you will easily get out." The Fox and the Woodcutter. A fox, running before the hounds, came across a woodcutter felling an oak and begged him to show him a safe hiding place. The woodcutter advised him to take shelter in his own hut, so the fox crept in and hid himself in a corner. The huntsman soon came up with his hounds and inquired of the woodcutter if he had seen the fox. He declared that he had not seen him, and yet pointed all the time he was speaking to the hut where the fox lay hidden. The huntsman took no notice of the signs, but believing his word, hastened forward in the chase. As soon as they were well away, the fox departed without taking any notice of the woodcutter, whereon he called to him and reproached him, saying, "You ungrateful fellow! You owe your life to me, and yet you leave me without a word of thanks." The fox replied, "Indeed, I should have thanked you fervently, if your deeds had been as good as your words, and if your hands had not been traitors to your speech." The Birdcatcher, the Partridge, and the Cock. A birdcatcher was about to sit down to a dinner of herbs when a friend unexpectedly came in. The bird trap was quite empty, as he had caught nothing, and he had to kill a pied partridge which he had tamed for a decoy. The bird entreated earnestly for his life. "What would you do without me when next you spread your nets? Who would chirp you to sleep or call you the covey of answering birds?" The birdcatcher spared his life and determined to pick out a fine young cock just attaining to his comb. But the cock expostulated in piteous tones from his perch. "If you kill me, who will announce you to the appearance of the dawn? Who will awake you to your daily tasks, or tell you when it is time to visit the bird trap in the morning?" He replied, "What you say is true. You are a capital bird at telling the time of day, but my friend and I must have our dinners. Necessity knows no law." The Monkey and the Fisherman. A monkey perched on a lofty tree saw some fishermen casting their nets into a river and narrowly watched their proceedings. The fishermen, after a while, gave up fishing and on going home to dinner left their nets upon the bank. The monkey, who is the most imitative of animals, descended from the treetop and endeavored to do as they had done. Having handled the net, he threw it into the river, but became tangled in the meshes and drowned. With his last breath, he said to himself, "I am rightly served. For what business had I, who had never handled a net, to try and catch fish?" The Flea and the Wrestler. A flea settled upon the bare foot of a wrestler and bit him, causing the man to call loudly upon Hercules for help. When the flea a second time hopped upon his foot, he groaned and said, "Oh, Hercules, if you will not help me against a flea, how can I hope for your assistance against greater antagonists?" The Two Frogs. Two frogs dwelt in the same pool. When the pool dried up under the summer's heat, they left it and set out together for another home. As they went along, they chanced to pass a deep well, amply supplied with water, and when they saw it, one of the frogs said to the other, "Let us descend and make our abode in this well. It will furnish us with shelter and food." The other replied with greater caution, "But suppose the water should fail us? How can we get out again from so great a depth?" Do nothing without a regard to the consequences. The Cat and the Mice. A certain house was overrun with mice. A cat, discovering this, made her way into it, and began to catch and eat them one by one. Fearing for their lives, the mice kept themselves close in their holes. The cat was no longer able to get at them, and perceived that she must tempt them forth by some device. For this purpose, she jumped upon a peg, and suspending herself from it, pretended to be dead. One of the mice, peeping stealthily out, saw her and said, "Ah, my good madam, Even though you should turn into a meal bag, we will not come near you. The Lion, the Bear, and the Fox. A lion and a bear seized a kid at the same moment and fought fiercely for its possession. When they had fearfully lacerated each other and were faint from the long combat, they lay exhausted with fatigue. A fox, who had gone round them at a distance several times, saw them both stretched on the ground with the kid lying untouched in the middle. He ran in between them, and seizing the kid, scampered off as fast as he could. The lion and the bear saw him, but not being able to get up, said,
"Woe be to us, that we should have fought and belabored ourselves, only to serve the turn of a fox."
It sometimes happens that one man has all the toil, and another all the profit. The Doe and the Lion. A doe, hard-pressed by hunters, sought refuge in a cave belonging to a lion. The lion concealed himself on seeing her approach, but when she was safe within the cave, sprang upon her and tore her to pieces.
"Woe is me," exclaimed the doe, "who have escaped from man, only to throw myself into the mouth of a wild beast."
In avoiding one evil, care must be taken not to fall into another. The Farmer and the Fox. A farmer who bore a grudge against a fox for robbing his poultry yard caught him at last, and being determined to take an ample revenge, tied some rope well soaked in oil to his tail and set it on fire. The fox, by a strange fatality, rushed to the fields of the farmer who had captured him. It was the time of the wheat harvest, but the farmer reaped nothing that year and returned home grieving sorely. The Seagull and the Kite. A seagull, having bolted down too large a fish, burst its deep gullet bag and lay down on the shore to die. A kite saw him and exclaimed, "You richly deserve your fate, for a bird of the air has no business to seek its food from the sea." Every man should be content to mind his own business. The Philosopher, the Ants, and Mercury. A philosopher witnessed from the shore the shipwreck of a vessel, of which the crew and passengers were all drowned. He inveighed against the injustice of Providence, which would, for the sake of one criminal perchance sailing in the ship, allow so many innocent persons to perish. As he was indulging in these reflections, he found himself surrounded by a whole army of ants, near whose nest he was standing. One of them climbed up and stung him, and he immediately trampled them all to death with his foot. Mercury presented himself, and striking the philosopher with his wand, said,
"And are you indeed to make yourself a judge of the dealings of Providence, who hast thyself in a similar manner treated these poor ants?"
The Mouse and the Bull. A bull was bitten by a mouse, and, angered by the wound, tried to capture him. But the mouse reached his hole in safety. Though the bull dug into the walls with his horns, he tired before he could rout out the mouse, and crouching down, went to sleep outside the hole. The mouse peeped out, crept furtively up his flank, and again, biting him, retreated to his hole. The bull, rising up and not knowing what to do, was sadly perplexed, at which the mouse said,
"The great do not always prevail. There are times when the small and lowly are the strongest to do mischief."
The Lion and the Hare. A lion came across a hare who was fast asleep. He was just in the act of seizing her when a fine young hart trotted by, and he left the hare to follow him. The hare, scared by the noise, awoke and scudded away. The lion was unable after a long chase to catch the hart, and returned to feed upon the hare. On finding that the hare also had run off, he said,
"I am rightly served for having let go of the food that I had in my hand for the chance of obtaining more."
The Peasant and the Eagle. A peasant found an eagle captured in a trap, and much admiring the bird, set him free. The eagle did not prove ungrateful to his deliverer, for seeing the peasant sitting under a wall which was not safe, he flew toward him and with his talons snatched a bundle from his head. When the peasant rose in pursuit, the eagle let the bundle fall again. Taking it up, the man returned to the same place to find that the wall under which he had been sitting had fallen to pieces, and he marveled at the service rendered him by the eagle.
The Image of Mercury and the Carpenter. A very poor man, a carpenter by trade, had a wooden image of Mercury, before which he made offerings day by day, and begged the idol to make him rich. But in spite of his entreaties, he became poorer and poorer. At last, being very angry, he took his image down from its pedestal and dashed it against a wall. When its head was knocked off, out came a stream of gold, which the carpenter quickly picked up and said, "Well, I think thou art altogether contradictory and unreasonable, for when I paid you honor, I reaped no benefits, but now that I maltreat you, I am loaded with an abundance of riches." The Bull and the Goat. A bull, escaping from a lion, hid in a cave which some shepherds had recently occupied. As soon as he entered, a he-goat, left in the cave, sharply attacked him with his horns. The bull quietly addressed him, "Butt away as much as you will. I have no fear of you, but of the lion. Let that monster go away, and I will soon let you know what is the respective strength of a goat and a bull." It shows an evil disposition to take advantage of a friend in distress. The Dancing Monkeys. A prince had some monkeys trained to dance. Being naturally great mimics of men's actions, they showed themselves most apt pupils, and when arrayed in their rich clothes and masks, they danced as well as any of the courtiers. The spectacle was often repeated with great applause, till on one occasion a courtier bent on mischief took from his pocket a handful of nuts and threw them upon the stage. The monkeys, at the sight of the nuts, forgot their dancing and became, as indeed they were, monkeys instead of actors. Pulling off their masks and tearing their robes, they fought with one another for the nuts. The dancing spectacle thus came to an end amidst the laughter and ridicule of the audience. The Fox and the Leopard. The fox and the leopard disputed which was the more beautiful of the two. The leopard exhibited one by one the various spots which decorated his skin, but the fox, interrupting him, said, "And how much more beautiful than you am I, who am decorated not in body, but in mind." The Monkeys and Their Mother. The monkey, it is said, has two young ones at each birth. The mother fondles one and nurtures it with the greatest affection and care, but hates and neglects the other. It happened once that the young one, which was caressed and loved, was smothered by the too great affection of the mother, while the despised one was nurtured and reared in spite of the neglect to which it was exposed. The best intentions will not always ensure success. The Oaks and Jupiter. The oaks presented a complaint to Jupiter, saying,
"We bear for no purpose the burden of life. As of all the trees that grow, we are the most continually in peril of the axe."
Jupiter made answer, "You have only to thank yourselves for the misfortunes to which you are exposed. For if you did not make such excellent pillars and posts, and prove yourselves so serviceable to the carpenters and the farmers, the axe would not so frequently be laid to your roots." The Hare and the Hound. A hound started a hare from his lair, but after a long run gave up the chase. A goatherd, seeing him stop, mocked him, saying,
"Oh, the little one is the best runner of the two."
The hound replied, "You do not see the difference between us. I was only running for a dinner, but he for his life." The Traveller and Fortune. A traveller, wearied from a long journey, lay down, overcome with fatigue, on the very brink of a deep well. Just as he was about to fall into the water, Dame Fortune, it is said, appeared to him, and waking him from his slumber, thus addressed him.
"Good sir, pray wake up, for if you fall into the well, the blame will be thrown on me, and I shall get an ill name among mortals, for I find that men are sure to impute their calamities to me, however much their own folly they have really brought on themselves."
Everyone is more or less master of his own fate.
The Wolf and the Lamb. Wolf, meeting with a lamb astray from the fold, resolved not to lay violent hands on him, but to find some plea to justify to the lamb the wolf's right to eat him. He thus addressed him, "Sir, last year you grossly insulted me." "Indeed," bleated the lamb in a mournful tone of voice, "but I was not then born."
Then said the wolf, "You feed in my pasture."
"No, good sir," replied the lamb. "I have not yet tasted grass."
Again said the wolf,
"You drink of my well."
"No," exclaimed the lamb, "I never yet drank water, for as yet my mother's milk is both food and drink to me."
Upon which the wolf seized him and ate him up, saying,
"I won't remain supperless, even though you refute every one of my imputations."
The tyrant will always find a pretext for his tyranny.
The Bat and the Weasels. A bat, who fell upon the ground and was caught by a weasel, pleaded to be spared his life. The weasel refused, saying that he was by nature the enemy of all birds. The bat assured him that he was not a bird, but a mouse, and thus was set free. Shortly afterwards, the bat again fell to the ground and was caught by another weasel, whom he likewise entreated not to eat him. The weasel said that he had a special hostility to mice. The bat assured him that he was not a mouse, but a bat, and thus a second time escaped. It is wise to turn circumstances to good account.
The Ass and the Grasshopper. An ass, having heard some grasshoppers chirping, was highly enchanted, and desiring to possess the same charms of melody, demanded of what sort of food they lived on to give them such beautiful voices. They replied, "The dew." The ass resolved that he would live only upon dew, and in a short time died of hunger.
The Lion and the Mouse. A lion was awakened from sleep by a mouse running over his face. Rising up angrily, he caught him and was about to kill him, when the mouse piteously entreated, saying,
"If you would only spare my life, I would be sure to repay your kindness."
The lion laughed and let him go.
It happened shortly after this that the lion was caught by some hunters, who bound him up with strong ropes to the ground. The mouse, recognizing his roar, came and gnawed the rope with his teeth and set him free, exclaiming,
"You ridicule the idea of my ever being able to help you, not expecting to receive from me any repayment of your favor. Now you know that it is possible for even a mouse to convey benefits on a lion."
The Charcoal Burner and the Fuller. A charcoal burner carried on his trade in his own house. One day he met a friend, a fuller, and entreated him to come and live with him, saying that they should be far better neighbors, and that their housekeeping expenses would be lessened. The fuller replied,
"The arrangement is impossible as far as I am concerned, for whatever I should whiten, you would immediately blacken again with your charcoal."
Like will draw like.
The Father and His Sons. A father had a family of sons who were perpetually quarreling among themselves. He determined to give them a practical illustration of the evils of disunion, and for this purpose he one day told them to bring a bundle of sticks. When they had done so, he placed the faggot into the hands of each of them in succession, and ordered them to break it in pieces. They tried with all their strength, and were not able to do it. He next opened the faggot, took the sticks separately, one by one, and again put them into his son's hands, upon which they broke them easily. He then addressed them in these words,
"My sons, if you are of one mind, and unite to assist each other, you will be as this faggot, uninjured by all the attempts of your enemies. But if you are divided among yourselves, you will be broken as easily as these sticks."
The Boy Hunting Locusts.
A boy was hunting for locusts. He had caught a goodly number when he saw a scorpion, and mistaking him for a locust, reached out his hand to take him. The scorpion, showing his sting, said,
"If you had but touched me, my friend, you would have lost me, and all your locusts, too."
The Cock and the Jewel. A cock, scratching for food for himself and his hens, found a precious stone and exclaimed, "If your owner had found thee, and not I, he would have taken thee up, and have set thee in thy first estate. But I have found thee for no purpose. I would rather have one barleycorn than all the jewels in the world." The Kingdom of the Lion. The beasts of the field and forest had a lion as their king. He was neither wrathful, cruel, nor tyrannical, but just and gentle as a king could be. During his reign, he made a royal proclamation for a general assembly of all the birds and beasts, and drew up conditions for a universal league in which the wolf and the lamb, the panther and the kid, the tiger and the stag, the dog and the hare should all live together in perfect peace and amity. The hare said, "Oh, how I have longed to see this day in which the weak shall take their place with impunity by the side of the strong." And after the hare said this, he ran for his life. The Wolf and the Crane. A wolf who had a bone stuck in his throat hired a crane for a large sum to put her head into his mouth and draw out the bone. When the crane had extracted the bone and demanded the promised payment, the wolf, grinning and grinding his teeth, exclaimed, "Why, you have surely already had a sufficient recompense in having been permitted to draw out your head in safety from the mouth and jaws of a wolf." In serving the wicked, expect no reward, and be thankful if you escape injury for your pains. The Fisherman Piping. A fisherman, skilled in music, took his flute and his nets to the seashore. Standing on a projecting rock, he played several times in the hope that the fish, attracted by his melody, would of their own accord dance into his nets, which he had placed below. At last, having long waited in vain, he laid aside his flute, and casting his net into the sea, made an excellent haul of fish. When he saw them leaping about in the net upon the rock, he said, "Oh, you most perverse creatures! When I piped, you would not dance. But now that I have ceased, you do so merrily." Hercules and the Wagoner. A carter was driving a wagon along a country lane when the wheels sank down deep into a rut. The rustic driver, stupefied and aghast, stood looking at the wagon and did nothing but utter loud cries to Hercules to come and help him. Hercules, it is said, appeared and thus addressed him. "Put your shoulders to the wheels, my man. Go down your bullocks and never more pray to me for help until you have done your best to help yourself, or depend upon it, you will henceforth pray in vain." Self-help is the best help. The Ants and the Grasshopper. The ants were spending a fine winter's day drying grain collected in the summertime. A grasshopper, perishing with famine, passed by and earnestly begged for a little food. The ants inquired of him, "Why did you not treasure up food during the summer?" He replied, "I had not leisure enough. I passed the days in singing." They then said in derision, "If you were foolish enough to sing all the summer, you must dance supperless to bed in the winter."
The Traveler and His Dog. A traveler, about to set out on a journey, saw his dog stand at the door stretching himself. He asked sharply, "Why do you stand there gaping? Everything is ready but you, so come with me instantly."
The dog, wagging his tail, replied, "Oh, master, I'm quite ready. It is you for whom I'm waiting."
The loiterer often blames delay on his more active friend. The Dog and the Shadow. A dog, crossing a bridge over a stream with a piece of flesh in his mouth, saw his own shadow in the water and took it for that of another dog, with a piece of meat double his own size. He immediately let go of his own and fiercely attacked the other dog to get his larger piece for him. He thus lost both, that which he grasped at in the water because it was a shadow, and his own because the stream swept it away.
The Mole and His Mother. A mole, a creature blind from birth, once said to his mother, "I am sure that I can see, mother." In a desire to prove him his mistake, his mother placed before him a few grains of frankincense and said, "What is it?" The young mole said, "It is a pebble." His mother exclaimed, "My son, I'm afraid that you are not only blind, but that you have lost your sense of smell."
The Herdsman and the Lost Bull. A herdsman, tending his flock in a forest, lost a bull calf from the fold. After a long and fruitless search, he made a vow that if he could only discover the thief who had stolen the calf, he would offer a lamb in sacrifice to Hermes, Pan, and the guardian deities of the forest. Not long afterwards, as he ascended a small hillock, he saw at its foot a lion feeding on the calf. Terrified at the sight, he lifted his eyes and his hands to heaven and said, "Just now I vowed to offer a lamb to the guardian deities of the forest if only I could find out who robbed me. But now that I have discovered the thief, I would willingly add a full-grown bull to the calf I have lost, if I may only secure my own escape from him in safety." The Hare and the Tortoise. A hare one day ridiculed the short feet and slow pace of the tortoise, who replied, laughing, "Though you be as swift as the wind, I will beat you in a race." The hare, believing her assertion to be simply impossible, assented to the proposal, and they agreed that the fox should choose the course and fix the goal. On the day appointed for the race, the two started together. The tortoise never for a moment stopped, but went on with a slow but steady pace straight to the end of the course. The hare, lying down by the wayside, fell fast asleep. At last, waking up and moving as fast as he could, he saw the tortoise had reached the goal and was comfortably dozing after her fatigue. Slow but steady wins the race. The Pomegranate, Apple Tree, and Bramble. The pomegranate and apple tree disputed as to which was the most beautiful. When their strife was at its height, a bramble from the neighboring hedge lifted up its voice and said in a boastful tone, "Pray, my dear friends, in my presence, at least cease from such vain disputings." The Farmer and the Stork. A farmer placed nets on his newly sown plowlands and caught a number of cranes which had come to pick up his seed. With them he trapped a stork that had fractured his leg in the net and was earnestly beseeching the farmer to spare his life. "Pray save me, master," he said, "and let me go free this once. My broken limb should excite you a pity. Besides, I'm no crane, I'm a stork, a bird of excellent character, and see how I love and slave for my father and mother. Look, too, at my feathers. They are not the least like that of a crane." "It may well be all as you say. I only know this. I have taken you with these robbers, the cranes, and you must die in their company. Birds of a feather flock together." The Farmer and the Snake. One winter, a farmer found a snake stiff and frozen with cold. He had compassion on it, and taking it up, placed it in his bosom. The snake was quickly revived by the warmth, and resuming its natural instincts, bit its benefactor, inflicting on him a mortal wound. "Oh," cried the farmer with his last breath, "I am rightly served for pitying a scoundrel." The greatest kindness will not bind the ungrateful. The Herdsman and the Lost Bull. A herdsman, tending his flock in a forest, lost a bull calf from the fold. After a long and fruitless search, he made a vow that if he could only discover the thief who had stolen the calf, he would offer a lamb in sacrifice to Hermes, Pan, and the guardian deities of the forest. Not long afterwards, as he ascended a small hillock, he saw at its foot a lion feeding on the calf. Terrified at the sight, he lifted his eyes and his hands to heaven and said, "Just now I vowed to offer a lamb to the guardian deities of the forest if only I could find out who robbed me. But now that I have discovered the thief, I would willingly add a full-grown bull to the calf I have lost, if I may only secure my own escape from him in safety." The Fawn and His Mother. A young fawn once said to his mother, "You are larger than a dog, and swifter, and more used to running, and you have your horns as a defense. Why then, O mother, do the hounds frighten you so?" She smiled and said, "I know full well, my son, that all you say is true. I have the advantages you mention, but when I hear even the bark of a simple dog, I feel quite ready to faint and fly away as fast as I can." No arguments will give courage to the coward. The Bear and the Fox. A bear boasted very much of his philanthropy, saying that, of all animals, he was the most tender in his regard to man, for he had such respect for him that he would not even touch his dead body. A fox, hearing these words, said with a smile to the bear, "Oh, that you would eat the dead and not the living!" The Swallow and the Crow. The swallow and the crow had a contention about their plumage. The crow put an end to the dispute by saying, "Your feathers are all very well in the spring, but mine protect me against the winter. Fair weather friends are not worth much." The Mountain in Labor. A mountain was once greatly agitated. Loud groans and noises were heard, and crowds of people came from all parts to see what was the matter. While they were assembled in anxious expectation of some terrible calamity, out came a mouse. "Don't make much ado about nothing." The Ass, the Fox, and the Lion. The ass and the fox, having entered into partnership together for their mutual protection, went out into the forest to hunt. They had not proceeded far when they met a lion. The fox, seeing imminent danger, approached the lion and promised to contrive for him the capture of the ass if the lion would pledge his word not to harm the fox. Then, upon assuring the ass that he would not be injured, the fox led him into a deep pit and arranged that he should fall into it. The lion, seeing that the ass was secured, immediately clutched the fox and attacked the ass at his leisure. The Tortoise and the Eagle. A tortoise, lazily basking in the sun, complained to the seabirds of her hard fate, that no one would teach her to fly. An eagle, hovering near, heard her lamentation and demanded what reward she would give him if he would take her aloft and float her in the air. "I will give you," she said, "all the riches of the Red Sea."
"I will teach you to fly, then," said the eagle,
and taking her up in his talons, he carried her almost to the clouds. Suddenly he let her go, and she fell on a lofty mountain, dashing her shell to pieces. The tortoise exclaimed in the moment of death, "I have deserved my present fate, for what had I to do with wings and clouds, who can only with difficulty move about on the earth?" If men had all they wished, they would be often ruined. The Flies and the Honey Pot. A number of flies were attracted to a jar of honey which had been overturned in a housekeeper's room, and placing their feet in it, ate greedily. Their feet, however, became so smeared with the honey that they could not use their wings nor release themselves, and were suffocated. Just as they were expiring, they exclaimed, "Oh, foolish creatures that we are! For the sake of a little pleasure, we have destroyed ourselves!" Pleasure, brought with pains, hurts. The Man and the Lion. A man and a lion traveled together through the forest. They soon began to boast of their respective superiority to each other in strength and prowess. As they were disputing, they passed a statue carved in stone which represented a lion strangled by a man. The traveler pointed to it and said,
"See there, how strong we are, and how we prevail over even the king of beasts!"
The lion replied, "This statue was made by one of your men. If we lions knew how to erect statues, you would see the man placed under the paw of the lion." One story is good till another is told. The Farmer and the Cranes. Some cranes made their feeding grounds in some plowlands newly sowed with wheat. For a long time the farmer, brandishing an empty sling, chased them away by the terror he inspired. But when the birds found that the sling was only swung in the air, they ceased to take any notice of it and would not move. The farmer, on seeing this, charged his sling with stones and killed a great number. The remaining birds at once forsook his fields, crying to each other,
"It is time for us to be off to Lilliput, for this man is no longer content to scare us, but begins to show us in earnest what he can do."
If words suffice not, blows must follow.
The Jackdaw and the Fox. A half-famished jackdaw seated himself on a fig tree, which had produced some fruit entirely out of season, and waited in the hope that the figs would ripen. A fox, seeing him sitting so long, and learning the reason of his doing so, said to him, "You are indeed, sir, sadly deceiving yourself, You're indulging a hope strong enough to cheat you, but which will never reward you with enjoyment. The Lark Burying Her Father. The lark, according to an ancient legend, was created before the earth itself, and when her father died, as there was no earth, she could find no place of burial for him. She let him lie uninterred for 5 days, and on the sixth day, not knowing what else to do, she buried him in her own head. Hence, she obtained her crest, which is popularly said to be her father's grave hillock. Youth's first duty is reverence to parents. The Gnat and the Bull. A gnat settled on the horn of a bull and sat there a long time. Just as he was about to fly off, he made a buzzing noise and inquired of the bull if he would like him to go. The bull replied,
"I did not know you had come, and I shall not miss you when you go away."
Some men are of more consequence in their own eyes than in the eyes of their neighbors. The Bitch and Her Whelps. A bitch, ready to whelp, earnestly begged a shepherd for a place where she might litter. When her request was granted, she besought permission to rear her puppies in the same spot. The shepherd again consented. But at last the bitch, protected by the bodyguard of her whelps, who had now grown up and were able to defend themselves, asserted her exclusive right to the place and would not permit the shepherd to approach. The Dogs and the Hides. Some dogs, famished with hunger, saw a number of cowhides steeping in a river. Not being able to reach them, they agreed to drink up the river. But it happened that they burst themselves with drinking long before they reached the hides. Attempt not impossibilities. The Shepherd and the Sheep. A shepherd, driving his sheep to a wood, saw an oak of unusual size full of acorns, and spreading his cloak under the branches, he climbed up into the tree and shook them down. The sheep, eating the acorns, inadvertently frayed and tore the cloak. When the shepherd came down and saw what was done, he said, "Oh, you most ungrateful creatures! You provide wool to make garments for all other men, but you destroy the clothes of him who feeds you." The Grasshopper and the Owl. An owl, accustomed to feed at night and to sleep during the day, was greatly disturbed by the noise of a grasshopper and earnestly besought her to stop chirping. The grasshopper refused to desist and chirped louder and louder the more the owl entreated. When she saw that she could get no redress and that her words were despised, the owl attacked the chatterer by a stratagem. "Since I cannot sleep," she said, "on account of your song, which, believe me, is sweet as the lyre of Apollo, I shall indulge myself in drinking some nectar which Pallas lately gave me. If you do not dislike it, come to me, and we will drink together." The grasshopper, who was thirsty and pleased with the praise of her voice, eagerly flew up. The owl came forth from her hollow, seized her, and put her to death. The Monkey and the Camel. The beasts of the forest gave a splendid entertainment, at which the monkey stood up and danced. Having vastly delighted the assembly, he sat down amidst universal applause. The camel, envious of the praises bestowed on the monkey, and desiring to divert to himself the favor of the guests, proposed to stand up in his turn and dance for their amusement. He moved about in so utterly ridiculous a manner that the beasts, in a fit of indignation, set upon him with clubs and drove him out of the assembly. It is absurd to ape our betters. The Peasant and the Apple Tree. A peasant had in his garden an apple tree, which bore no fruit, but only served as a harbor for the sparrows and the grasshoppers. He resolved to cut it down, and, taking his axe in hand, made a bold stroke at its roots. The grasshoppers and sparrows entreated him not to cut down the tree that sheltered them, but to spare it, and they would sing to him and lighten his labors. He paid no attention to their request, but gave the tree a second and a third blow with the axe. When he reached the hollow of the tree, he found a hive full of honey. Having tasted the honeycomb, he threw down his axe, and looking on the tree as sacred, took great care of it. Self-interest alone moves some men. The Two Soldiers and the Robber. Two soldiers traveling together were set upon by a robber. The one fled away. The other stood his ground and defended himself with his stout right hand. The robber being slain, the timid companion ran up and drew his sword, and then, throwing back his traveling cloak, said, "I'll at him, and I'll take care he shall learn whom he has attacked." On this, he who had fought with the robber made answer, "I only wish that you had helped me just now, even if it had been only with those words, for I should have been the more encouraged, believing them to be true. But now put up your sword in its sheath, and hold your equally useless tongue. I, indeed, who have experienced with what speed you run away, know right well that no dependence can be placed on your valor." The Trees Under the Protection of the Gods. The gods, according to an ancient legend, made choice of certain trees to be under their special protection. Jupiter chose the oak, Venus the myrtle, Apollo the laurel, Cybele the pine, and Hercules the poplar. Minerva, wondering why they had preferred trees not yielding fruit, inquired the reason for their choice. Jupiter replied, "It is lest we should seem to covet the honor for the fruit." But Minerva said,
"Let anyone say what he will. The olive is more dear to me on account of its fruit."
Then said Jupiter,
"My daughter, you are rightly called wise, for unless what we do is useful, the glory of it is vain."
The Mother and the Wolf. A famished wolf was prowling about in the morning in search of food. As he passed the door of a cottage built in the forest, he heard a mother say to her child,
"Be quiet, or I will throw you out of the window, and the wolf shall eat you."
The wolf sat all day waiting at the door. In the evening, he heard the same woman fondling her child and saying,
"You are quiet now, and if the wolf should come, we will kill him."
The wolf, hearing these words, went home, gasping with cold and hunger. When he reached his den, Mistress Wolf inquired of him why he returned wearied and supperless, so contrary to his wont. He replied,
"Why, forsooth, use I gave credence to the words of a woman."
The Ass and the Horse. An ass besought a horse to spare him a small portion of his feed.
"Yes,"
said the horse,
"if any remains out of what I am now eating, I will give it you for the sake of my own superior dignity. And if you will come when I reach my own stall in the evening, I will give you a little sack full of barley."
The ass replied,
"Thank you, but I can't think that you, who refuse me a little matter now, will by and by confer on me a greater benefit."
Truth and the Traveler. A wayfaring man, traveling in the desert, met a woman standing alone and terribly dejected. He inquired of her,
"Who art thou?"
"My name is Truth," she replied.
"And for what cause,"
he asked,
"have you left the city to dwell alone here in the wilderness?"
She made answer,
"Because in former times falsehood was with few, but is now with all men."
The Manslayer. A man committed a murder and was pursued by the relations of the man whom he murdered. On his reaching the River Nile, he saw a lion on its bank, and being fearfully afraid, climbed up a tree. He found a serpent in the upper branches of the tree, and again being greatly alarmed, he threw himself into the river, where a crocodile caught him and ate him. Thus the earth, the air, and the water alike refused shelter to a murderer. The Lion and the Fox. A fox entered into partnership with a lion, on the pretense of becoming his servant. Each undertook his proper duty in accordance with his own nature and powers. The fox discovered and pointed out the prey. The lion sprang on it and seized it. The fox soon became jealous of the lion, carrying off the lion's share, and said that he would no longer find out the prey, but would capture it in his own account. The next day he attempted to snatch a lamb from the fold, but he himself fell prey to the huntsmen and hounds. The Lion and the Eagle. An eagle stayed his flight and entreated a lion to make an alliance with him to their mutual advantage. The lion replied,
"I have no objection, but you must excuse me for requiring you to find surety for your good faith. For how can I trust anyone as a friend who is able to fly away from his bargain whenever he pleases?"
Try before you trust. The Hen and the Swallow. A hen, finding the eggs of a viper and carefully keeping them warm, nourished them into life. A swallow, observing what she had done, said,
"You silly creature, why have you hatched these vipers, which, when they shall have grown, will inflict injury on all, beginning with yourself?"
The Buffoon and the Countryman. A rich nobleman once opened the theaters without charge to the people, and gave a public notice that he would handsomely reward any person who invented a new amusement for the occasion. Various public performers contended for the prize. Among them came a buffoon, well known among the populace for his jokes, and said that he had a kind of entertainment which had never been brought out on any stage before. This report being spread about made a great stir, and the theater was crowded in every part. The buffoon appeared alone up on the platform, without any apparatus or confederates, and the very sense of expectation caused an intense silence. He suddenly bent his head toward his bosom and imitated the squeaking of a little pig so admirably with his voice that the audience declared he had a porker under his cloak and demanded that it should be shaken out. When that was done and nothing was found, they cheered the actor and loaded him with the loudest applause. A countryman in the crowd, observing all that had passed, said,
"So help me, Hercules, he shall not beat me at that trick,"
and at once proclaimed that he would do the same thing on the next day, though in a much more natural way. On the morrow, a still larger crowd assembled in the theater, but now partiality for their favorite actor very generally prevailed, and the audience came rather to ridicule the countryman than to see the spectacle. Both of the performers appeared on the stage. The buffoon grunted and squeaked away first, and obtained, as on the preceding day, the applause and cheers of the spectators. Next, the countryman commenced, and pretending that he concealed a little pig beneath his clothes, which in truth he did, but not suspected by the audience, contrived to take hold of and to pull his ear, causing the pig to squeak. The crowd, however, cried out with one consent that the buffoon had given a far more exact imitation, and clamored for the countryman to be kicked out of the theater. On this, the rustic produced the little pig from his cloak, and showed, by the most positive proof, the greatness of their mistake.
"Look here," he said, "this shows what sort of judges you are."
The Crow and the Serpent. A crow, in great want of food, saw a serpent asleep in a sunny nook, and flying down, greedily seized him. The serpent, turning about, bit the crow with a mortal wound. In the agony of death, the bird exclaimed,
"Oh, unhappy me, who have found in that which I deemed a happy windfall the source of my destruction."
The Hunter and the Horseman. A certain hunter, having snared a hare, placed it upon his shoulders and set out homewards. On his way he met a man on horseback, who begged the hare of him, under the pretense of purchasing it. However, when the horseman got the hare, he rode off as fast as he could. The hunter ran after him, as if he was sure of overtaking him, but the horseman increased more and more the distance between them. The hunter, sorely against his will, called out to him and said,
"Get along with you! For now I will make you a present of the hare."
The King's Son and the Painted Lion. A king, whose only son was fond of martial exercises, had a dream in which he was warned that his son would be killed by a lion. Afraid the dream should prove true, he built for his son a pleasant palace and adorned its walls for his amusement with all kinds of life-size animals. among which was the picture of a lion. When the young prince saw this, his grief at being thus confined burst out afresh, and standing near the lion, he said,
"Oh, you most detestable of animals! Through a lying dream of my father's, which he saw in his sleep, I am shut up on your account in this palace as if I had been a girl. What shall I now do to you?"
With these words, he stretched out his hands toward a thorn tree, meaning to cut a stick from its branches so that he might beat the lion. But one of the tree's prickles pierced his finger and caused great pain and inflammation, so that the young prince fell down in a fainting fit. A violent fever suddenly set in, from which he died not many days later. We had better bear our troubles bravely than try to escape them. The Cat and Venus. A cat fell in love with a handsome young man and entreated Venus to change her into the form of a woman. Venus consented to her request and transformed her into a beautiful damsel, so that the youth saw her and loved her and took her home as his bride. While the two were reclining in their chamber, Venus, wishing to discover if the cat, in her change of shape, had also altered the habits of her life, let down a mouse in the middle of the room. The cat, quite forgetting her present condition, started up from the couch and pursued the mouse, wishing to eat it. Venus was much disappointed, and again caused her to return to her former shape. Nature exceeds nurture. The Camel and the Arab. An Arab camel driver, after completing the loading of his camel, asked him which he would like best, to go uphill or down. The poor beast replied, not without a touch of reason,
"Why do you ask me? Is it that the level way through the desert is closed?"
The Bold Knight. A bold knight who wore a wig went out to hunt. A sudden puff of wind blew off his hat and wig, at which a loud laugh ran forth from his companions. He pulled up his horse and with great glee joined in the joke by saying, "What a marvel it is that the hairs which are not mine should fly from me, when they have forsaken even the man on whose head they grew." The Shepherd and the Dog. A shepherd penning his sheep in the fold for the night was about to shut up a wolf with them, when his dog, perceiving the wolf, said, "Master, how can you expect the sheep to be safe if you admit a wolf into the fold?" The Lamp. A lamp soaked with too much oil and flaring brightly boasted that it gave more light than the sun. Then a sudden puff of wind arose, and the lamp was immediately extinguished. Its owner lit it again and said, "Boast no more, but henceforth be content to give thy light in silence. Know that not even the stars need to be relit." The Lion, the Fox, and the Ass. The lion, the fox, and the ass entered into an agreement to assist each other in the chase. Having secured a large booty, the lion, on their return from the forest, asked the ass to allot his due portion to each of the three partners in the treaty. The ass carefully divided the spoil into three equal shares, and modestly requested that the two others make the first choice. The lion, bursting out into a great rage, devoured the ass. Then he requested the fox to do him the favor to make a division. The fox accumulated all that they had killed into one large heap, and left to himself the smallest possible morsel. The lion said,
"Who has taught you, my very excellent fellow, the art of division? You are perfect to a fraction."
The lion said,
"Who has taught you, my excellent fellow, the art of division? You are perfect to a fraction."
He replied, "I learned it from the ass, by witnessing his fate." Happy is the man who learns from the misfortunes of others. The Bull, the Lioness, and the Wild Boar Hunter. A bull, finding a lion's cub asleep, gored him to death with his horns. The lioness came up and bitterly lamented the death of her whelp. A wild boar hunter, seeing her distress, stood at a distance and said to her, "Think how many men there are who have reason to lament the loss of their children, whose deaths have been caused by you." The Oak and the Woodcutters. The woodcutter cut down a mountain oak and split it in pieces, making wedges of its own branches for dividing the trunk. The oak said with a sigh,
"Oh, I do not care about the blows of the axe aimed at my roots, but I do grieve at being torn in pieces by these wedges made from my own branches."
Misfortunes springing from ourselves are the hardest to bear. The Hen and the Golden Eggs. A cottager and his wife had a hen that laid a golden egg every day. They supposed that the hen must contain a great lump of gold in its inside, and in order to get the gold, they killed it. Having done so, they found to their surprise that the hen differed in no respect from their other hens. The foolish pair, thus hoping to become rich all at once, deprived themselves of the gain of which they were assured day by day. The Ass and the Frogs. An ass, carrying a load of wood, passed through a pond. As he was crossing through the water, he lost his footing, stumbled, and fell, and not being able to rise on account of his load, groaned heavily. Some frogs frequenting the pool heard his lamentation and said, "What would you do if you had to live here always as we do, when you make such a fuss about a mere fall into the water?" Men often bear little grievances with less courage than they do large misfortunes. The Crow and the Raven. A crow was jealous of the raven because he was considered a bird of good omen and always attracted the attention of men who noted by his flight the good or evil course of future events. Seeing some travelers approaching, the crow flew up into a tree and, perching herself on one of the branches, cawed as loudly as she could. The travelers turned towards the sound and wondered what it foreboded, when one of them said to his companion, "Let us proceed on our journey, my friend, for it is only the caw of a crow, and her cry, you know, is no omen." Those who assume a character which does not belong to them only make themselves ridiculous. The Trees and the Axe. A man came into a forest and asked the trees to provide him a handle for his axe. The trees consented to his request and gave him a young ash tree. No sooner had the man fitted a new handle to his axe from it than he began to use it and quickly felled with his strokes the noblest giants of the forest. An old oak, lamenting when too late the destruction of his companions, said to a neighboring cedar,
"The last step has lost us all. If we had not given up the rights of the ash, we might yet have retained our own privileges and have stood for ages."
The Crab and the Fox. A crab, forsaking the seashore, chose a neighboring green meadow as its feeding ground. A fox came across him and, being very hungry, ate him up. Just as he was on the point of being eaten, the crab said, "I well deserve my fate, for what business had I on the land, when by my nature and habits I am only adapted for the sea?" Contentment with our lot is an element of happiness. The Woman and Her Hen. A woman possessed a hen that gave her an egg every day. She often pondered how she might obtain two eggs daily instead of one, and at last, to gain her purpose, determined to give the hen a double allowance of barley. From that day, the hen became fat and sleek, and never once laid another egg. The Ass and the Old Shepherd. A shepherd watching his ass feeding in a meadow was alarmed all of a sudden by the cries of the enemy. He appealed to the ass to fly with him, lest they should both be captured. But the animal lazily replied,
"Why should I pray? Do you think it likely the conqueror will place on me two sets of panniers?" "No," rejoined the shepherd. "Then," said the ass, "as long as I carry the panniers, what matters it to me whom I serve?"
In a change of government, the poor change nothing beyond the name of their master. The Kites and the Swans. The kites of olden times, as well as the swans, had the privilege of song. But having heard the neigh of the horse, they were so enchanted with the sound that they tried to imitate it, and in trying to neigh, they forgot how to sing. The desire for imaginary benefits often involves the loss of present blessings. The Wolves and the Sheepdogs. The wolves thus addressed the sheepdogs.
Why should you, who are like us in so many things, not be entirely of one mind with us, and live with us as brothers should? We differ from you in one point only. We live in freedom. You bow down to and slave for men who, in return for your services, flog you with whips and put collars on your necks. They make you also guard their sheep, and while they eat the mutton, throw only bones to you. If you will be persuaded by us, you will give us the sheep, and we will enjoy them in common, till we are all surfeited. The dogs listened favorably to these proposals, and entering the den of the wolves, they were set upon and torn to pieces. The Hares and the Foxes. The hares waged war with the eagles and called upon the foxes to help them. They replied, "We would willingly have helped you if we had not known who you were and with whom you were fighting. Count the cost before you commit yourselves." The Bowman and Lion. A very skillful bowman went to the mountains in search of game, but all the beasts of the forest fled at his approach. The lion alone challenged him to combat. The bowman immediately shot out an arrow and said to the lion, "I send thee my messenger, that from him thou mayst learn what I myself shall be when I assail thee." The wounded lion rushed away in great fear, and when a fox, who had seen it all happen, told him to be of good courage and not to back off at the first attack, he replied, "You counsel me in vain, for if he sends so fearful a messenger, how shall I abide the attack of the man himself?" Be on guard against men who can strike from a distance. The Camel. When man first saw the camel, he was so frightened at his vast size that he ran away. After a time, perceiving the meekness and gentleness of the beast's temper, he summoned courage enough to approach him. Soon afterwards, observing that he was an animal altogether deficient in spirit, he assumed such boldness as to put a bridle in his mouth and to let a child drive him. The Wasp and the Snake. A wasp seated himself upon the head of a snake, and striking him unceasingly with his stings, wounded him to death. The snake, being in great torment and not knowing how to rid himself of his enemy, saw a wagon heavily laden with wood, and went and purposely placed his head under the wheels, saying, "At least my enemy and I shall perish together." The Dog and the Hare. A hound, having started a hare on the hillside, pursued her for some distance, at one time biting her with his teeth, as if he would take her life, and at another fawning upon her as if in play with another dog. The hare said to him, "I wish you would act sincerely by me, and show yourself in your true colors. If you are a friend, why do you bite me so hard? If an enemy, why do you fawn on me?" No one can be a friend if you do not know whether to trust or distrust him. The Bull and the Calf. A bull was striving with all his might to squeeze himself through a narrow passage which led to his stall. A young calf came up and offered to go before him and show him the way by which he could manage to pass.
"Save yourself the trouble," said the bull. "I knew that way long before you were born."
The Stag, the Wolf, and the Sheep. A stag asked a sheep to lend him a measure of wheat, and said that the wolf would be his surety. The sheep, fearing some fraud was intended, excused herself, saying,
"The wolf is accustomed to seize what he wants, and to run off. But you, too, can quickly outstrip me in your rapid flight. How, then, shall I be able to find you when the day of payment comes?"
Two blacks do not make one white. The Peacock and the Crane. A peacock, spreading its gorgeous tail, mocked a crane that passed by, ridiculing the ashen hue of its plumage, and saying, "I am robed like a king, in gold and purple and all the colors of the rainbow, while you have not a bit of color on your wings." "True," replied the crane, "but I soar to the heights of heaven, and lift up my voice to the stars, while you walk below like a cock among the birds of the dunghill. Fine feathers don't make fine birds." The Fox and the Hedgehog. A fox, swimming across a rapid river, was carried by the force of the current into a very deep ravine, where he lay for a long time very much bruised, sick, and unable to move.
A swarm of hungry, blood-sucking flies settled upon him. A hedgehog, passing by, saw his anguish and inquired if he should drive away the flies that were tormenting him. "By no means," replied the fox. "Pray do not molest them."
"How is this?" said the hedgehog. "Do you not want to be rid of them?"
"No," returned the fox, "for these flies which you see are full of blood, and sting me but little. And if you rid me of these, which are already satiated, others more hungry will come in their place, and will drink up all the blood I have left."
The Eagle, the Cat, and the Wild Sow. An eagle made her nest at the top of a lofty oak. A cat, having found a convenient hole, moved into the middle of the trunk, and a wild sow, with her young, took shelter in a hollow at its foot. The cat cunningly resolved to destroy this chance-made colony. To carry out her design, she climbed to the nest of the eagle and said,
"Destruction is preparing for you and for me too, unfortunately. The wild sow, whom you see daily digging up the earth, wishes to uproot the oak, so she may on its fall seize our families as food for her young."
Having thus frightened the eagle out of her senses, she crept down to the cave of the sow and said,
"Oh, your children are in great danger, for as soon as you go out with your litter to find food, the eagle is prepared to pounce upon one of your little pigs."
Having instilled these fears into the sow, she went and pretended to hide herself in the hollow of the tree. When night came, she went forth with silent foot and obtained food for herself and her kittens, but feigning to be afraid, she kept a lookout all through the day. Meanwhile, the eagle, full of fear of the sow, sat still on the branches, and the sow, terrified by the eagle, did not dare go out of her cave. And thus they both, along with their families, perished from hunger and afforded ample provision for the cat and her kittens. The Mule. A mule, frolicsome from lack of work and from too much corn, galloped about in a very extravagant manner, and said to himself, "My father surely was a high-mettled racer, and I am his own child in speed and spirit." On the next day, being driven a long journey and feeling very wearied, he exclaimed in a disconsolate tone, "Oh, I must have made a mistake. My father, after all, could only have been an ass." The Thief and the Innkeeper. A thief hired a room in a tavern and stayed a while in the hope of stealing something which would enable him to pay his reckoning. When he had waited some days in vain, he saw the innkeeper dressed in a new and handsome coat and sitting before his door. The thief sat down beside him and talked with him. As the conversation began to flag, the thief yawned terribly and at the same time howled like a wolf. The innkeeper said,
"Why do you howl so fearfully?"
"I will tell you," said the thief. "But first let me ask you to hold my clothes, or I shall tear them to pieces."
"I know not, sir, when I got this habit of yawning, nor whether these attacks of howling were inflicted on me as a judgment for my crimes, or for any other cause. But this I do know, that when I yawn for the third time, I actually turn into a wolf and attack men."
With this speech he commenced a second fit of yawning, and again howled like a wolf as he had at first. The innkeeper, hearing his tale and believing what he said, became greatly alarmed, and rising from his seat, attempted to run away. The thief laid hold of his coat and entreated him to stop, saying,
"Pray wait, sir, and hold my clothes, or I shall tear them to pieces in my fury when I turn into a wolf."
At the same time he yawned the third time and set up a terrible howl. The innkeeper, frightened lest he should be attacked, left his new coat in the thief's hand and ran as fast as he could into the inn for safety. The thief made off with the coat and did not return again to the inn. Every tale is not to be believed. The Hart and the Vine. A hart, hard-pressed in the chase, hid himself beneath the large leaves of a vine. The huntsmen, in their haste, overshot the place of his concealment. Supposing all danger to have passed, the hart began to nibble the tendrils of the vine. One of the huntsmen, attracted by the rustling of the leaves, looked back and, seeing the hart, shot an arrow from his bow and struck it. The hart, at the point of death, groaned, "Oh, I am rightly served, for I should not have maltreated the vine that saved me." The Serpent and the Eagle. A serpent and an eagle were struggling with each other in deadly conflict. The serpent had the advantage, and was about to strangle the bird. A countryman saw them, and running up, loosed the coil of the serpent, and let the eagle go free. The serpent, irritated at the escape of his prey, injected his poison into the drinking horn of the countryman. The rustic, ignorant of his danger, was about to drink, when the eagle struck his hand with his wing, and seizing the drinking horn in his talons, carried it aloft. The Crow and the Pitcher. A crow, perishing with thirst, saw a pitcher, and hoping to find water, flew to it with delight. When he reached it, he discovered to his grief that it contained so little water that he could not possibly get at it. He tried everything he could think of to reach the water, but all his efforts were in vain. At last he collected as many stones as he could carry, and dropped them one by one with his beak into the pitcher, until he brought the water within his reach, and thus saved his life. Necessity is the mother of invention. The Two Frogs. Two frogs were neighbors. One inhabited a deep pond far removed from public view. The other lived in a gully containing little water and traversed by a country road. The frog that lived in the pond warned his friend to change his residence and entreated him to come and live with him, saying that he would enjoy greater safety from danger and more abundant food. The other refused, saying that he felt it was so very hard to leave a place to which he had become accustomed. A few days afterwards, a heavy wagon passed through the gully and crushed him to death under its wheels. A willful man will have his way to his own hurt.
The Dog in the Manger. A dog lay in a manger, and by his growling and snapping prevented the oxen from eating the hay which had been placed for them.
"What a selfish dog," said one of them to his companions. "He cannot eat the hay himself, and yet refuses to allow those to eat who can."
The Fox and the Goat. A fox one day fell into a deep well and could find no means of escape. A goat, overcome with thirst, came to the same well, and seeing the fox, inquired if the water was good. Concealing his sad plight under a merry guise, the fox indulged in a lavish praise of the water, saying it was excellent beyond measure, and encouraging him to descend. The goat, mindful only of his thirst, thoughtlessly jumped down. But just as he drank, the fox informed him of the difficulty they were both in, and suggested a scheme for their common escape.
"If," he said, "you will place your forefeet upon the wall and bend your head, I will run up your back and escape, and will help you out afterwards."
The goat readily assented, and the fox leaped upon his back. Steadying himself with the goat's horns, he safely reached the mouth of the well and made off as fast as he could. When the goat upbraided him for breaking his promise, he turned around and cried out,
"You foolish old fellow! If you had as many brains in your head as you have hairs in your beard, you would never have gone down before you inspected the way up, nor have exposed yourself to dangers from which you had no means of escape. Look before you leap."
The Bear and the Two Travelers. Two men were traveling together when a bear suddenly met them on their path. One of them climbed up quickly into a tree and concealed himself in the branches. The other, seeing that he must be attacked, fell flat on the ground, and when the bear came up and felt him with his snout and smelt him all over, he held his breath and feigned the appearance of death as much as he could. The bear soon left him, for it is said he will not touch a dead body. When he was quite gone, the other traveler descended from the tree and jocularly inquired of his friend what it was the bear had whispered in his ear.
"He gave me this advice," his companion replied, "never travel with a friend who deserts you at the approach of danger.
Misfortune tests the sincerity of friends." The Oxen and the Axle Trees. A heavy wagon was being dragged along a country lane by a team of oxen. The axle trees groaned and creaked terribly, whereupon the oxen, turning round, thus addressed the wheels.
"Hello there! Why do you make so much noise? We bear all the labor, and we, not you, ought to cry out."
"Those who suffer most cry out the least." The Thirsty Pigeon. A pigeon, oppressed by excessive thirst, saw a goblet of water painted on a signboard. Not supposing it to be only a picture, she flew towards it with a loud whir and unwittingly dashed against the signboard, jarring herself terribly.
Having broken her wings by the blow, she fell to the ground and was caught by one of the bystanders. Zeal should not outrun discretion. The Oxen and the Butchers. The oxen once upon a time sought to destroy the butchers, who practiced a trade destructive to their race. They assembled on a certain day to carry out their purpose and sharpened their horns for the contest. But one of them, who was exceedingly old, for many a field he had plowed, thus spoke, "These butchers, it is true, slaughter us, but they do so with skillful hands and with no unnecessary pain. If we got rid of them, we shall fall into the hands of unskillful operators, and thus suffer a double death. For you may be assured that though the butchers should perish, yet will men want beef." Do not be in a hurry to change one evil for another. The Lion, the Mouse, and the Fox. A lion, fatigued by the heat of a summer's day, fell fast asleep in his den. A mouse ran over his mane and ears and woke him from his slumbers. He rose up and shook himself in great wrath and searched every corner of his den to find the mouse. A fox, seeing him, said, "A fine lion you are to be frightened of a mouse." "'Tis not the mouse I fear," said the lion. "I resent his familiarity and ill-breeding. Little liberties are great offenses." The Vain Jackdaw. Jupiter determined, it is said, to create a sovereign over the birds, and made proclamation on a certain day that they should all present themselves before him, when he would himself choose the most beautiful among them to be king. The jackdaw, knowing of his ugliness, searched through the woods and fields and collected the feathers which had fallen from the wings of his companions and stuck them in all parts of his body, hoping thereby to make himself the most beautiful of all. When the appointed day arrived and the birds had assembled before Jupiter, the jackdaw also made his appearance in his many-feathered finery. But when Jupiter proposed to make him king because of the beauty of his plumage, the birds indignantly protested, and each plucked from him his own feathers, leaving the jackdaw nothing but a jackdaw. The Goatherd and the Wild Goats. A goat, driving his flock from their pasture at eventide, found some wild goats mingling among them, and shut them up together with his own for the night. The next day it snowed very hard, so that he could not take the herd to their usual feeding places, but was obliged to keep them in the fold. He gave his own goats just sufficient food to keep them alive, but fed the strangers more abundantly in the hope of enticing them to stay with him and making them his own. When the thaw set in, he led them all out to feed, and the wild goats scampered away as fast as they could to the mountains. The goatherd scolded them for their ingratitude in leaving him when during the storm he had taken more care of them than of his own herd. One of them, turning about, said to him, "That is the very reason why we are so cautious. For if you yesterday treated us better than the goats you have had so long, it is plain also that if others came after us, you would in the same manner prefer them to ourselves." Old friends cannot with impunity be sacrificed for new ones. The Mischievous Dog. A dog used to run up quietly to the heels of everyone he met, and to bite them without notice. His master suspended a bell around his neck so that the dog might give notice of his presence wherever he went. Thinking it a mark of distinction, the dog grew proud of his bell and went tinkling it all over the marketplace. One day an old hound said to him, "Why do you make such an exhibition of yourself? That bell that you carry is not, believe me, any order of merit, but on the contrary a mark of disgrace, a public notice to all men to avoid you as an ill-mannered dog." Notoriety is often mistaken for fame. The Fox Who Had Lost His Tail. A fox caught in a trap escaped, but in so doing lost his tail. Thereafter, feeling his life a burden from the shame and ridicule to which he was exposed, he schemed to convince all the other foxes that being tailless was much more attractive, thus making up for his own deprivation. He assembled a good many foxes and publicly advised them to cut off their tails, saying that they would not only look much better without them, but that they would get rid of the weight of the brush, which was a very great inconvenience. One of them, interrupting him, said, "If you had not yourself lost your tail, my friend, you would not thus counsel us." The Boy and the Nettles. A boy was stung by a nettle. He ran home and told his mother, saying, "Although it hurts me very much, I only touched it gently." "That is why it stung you," said his mother. "The next time you touch a nettle, grasp it boldly, and it will be soft as silk in your hand, and not in the least hurt you. Whatever you do, do with all your might." The Man and His Two Sweethearts. A middle-aged man, whose hair had begun to turn gray, courted two women at the same time. One of them was young, and the other well advanced in years. The elder woman, ashamed to be courted by a man younger than herself, made a point, whenever her admirer visited her, to pull out some portion of his black hairs. The younger, on the contrary, not wishing to become the wife of an old man, was equally zealous in removing every gray hair she could find. Thus it came to pass that between them both, he very soon found that he had not a hair left on his head. Those who seek to please everybody please nobody. The Ass, the Cock, and the Lion. An ass and a cock were in a straw yard together when a lion, desperate from hunger, approached the spot. He was about to spring upon the ass when the cock, to the sound of whose voice the lion, it is said, has a singular aversion, crowed loudly, and the lion fled away as fast as he could. The ass, observing his trepidation at the mere crowing of a cock, summoned courage to attack him, and galloped after him for that purpose. He had run no long distance when the lion turned about, seized him, and tore him to pieces. False confidence often leads into danger. The Mice and the Weasels. The weasels and the mice waged a perpetual war with each other in which much blood was shed. The weasels were always the victors. The mice thought that the cause of their frequent defeats was that they had no leaders set apart from the general army to command them, and that they were exposed to dangers from lack of discipline. They therefore chose as leaders mice that were most renowned for their family descent, strength, and counsel, as well as those most noted for their courage in the fight, so that they might be better marshaled in battle array, and formed into troops, regiments, and battalions. When all this was done and the army disciplined, and the herald mouse had duly proclaimed war by challenging the weasels, the newly chosen generals bound their heads with straws, that they might be more conspicuous to all their troops. Scarcely had the battle begun when a great rout overwhelmed the mice, who scampered off as fast as they could to their holes. The generals, not being able to get in on account of the ornaments on their heads, were all captured and eaten by the weasels. The more honor, the more danger. The Mice in Council. The mice summoned a council to decide how they might best devise a means of warning themselves of the approach of their great enemy, the cat. Among the many plans suggested, the one that found most favor was the proposal to tie a bell to the neck of the cat, so that the mice, being warned by the sound of the tinkling, might run away and hide themselves in their holes at his approach. But when the mice further debated who among them should thus bell the cat, there was no one found to do it. The Wolf and the House Dog. A wolf, meeting a big, well-fed mastiff with a wooden collar about his neck, asked him who it was that fed him so well and yet compelled him to drag about that heavy log wherever he went. "The master," he replied. Then said the wolf, "May no friend of mine ever be in such a plight, for the weight of this chain is enough to spoil the appetite." The Rivers and the Sea. The rivers joined together to complain to the sea, saying, "Why is it that when we flow into your tide so potable and sweet, you work in us such a change and make us salty and unfit to drink?" The sea, perceiving that they intended to throw the blame on him, said, "Pray cease to flow into me, and then you will not be made briny." The Playful Ass. An ass climbed up to the roof of a building, and frisking about there, broke in the tiling. The owner went up after him and quickly drove him down, beating him severely with a thick wooden cudgel. The ass said, "Why, I saw the monkey do this very thing yesterday, and you all laughed heartily, as if it afforded you very great amusement." The Ass Carrying the Image. An ass once carried through the streets of a city a famous wooden image, to be placed in one of its temples. As he passed along, the crowd made lowly prostration before the image. The ass, thinking that they had bowed their heads in token of respect for him, bristled up with pride, giving himself airs, and refused to move another step. The driver, seeing him thus stop, laid his whip lustily about his shoulders, and said, "Oh, you perverse dullhead, it is not yet come to this, that men pray worship to an ass. They are not wise who give to themselves the credit due to others." The Three Tradesmen. A great city was besieged, and its inhabitants were called together to consider the best means of protecting it from the enemy. A bricklayer earnestly recommended bricks as affording the best material for an effective resistance. A carpenter, with equal enthusiasm, proposed timber as a preferable method of defense, upon which a courier stood up and said, "Sirs, I differ from you altogether. There is no material for resistance equal to covering of hides, and nothing so good as leather. Every man for himself." The Dolphins, the Whales, and the Sprat. The dolphins and whales waged a fierce war with each other. When the battle was at its height, a sprat lifted its head out of the waves and said that he would reconcile their differences if they would accept him as an umpire. One of the dolphins replied, "We would far rather be destroyed in our battle with each other than admit any interference from you in our affairs." The Two Travelers and the Axe. Two men were journeying together. One of them picked up an axe that lay upon the path and said, "I have found an axe." "Nay, my friend," replied the other, "do not say I, say we have found an axe." They had not gone far before they saw the owner of the axe pursuing them, and he who had picked up the axe said, "We are undone." "Nay," replied the other, "keep to your first mode of speech, my friend, that you thought right then, think right now. Say I, not we, are undone. He who shares the danger ought to share the prize." The Old Hound. A hound, who in the days of his youth and strength had never yielded to any beast of the forest, encountered in his old age a boar in the chase. He seized him boldly by the ear, but could not retain his hold because of the decay of his teeth, so that the boar escaped. His master, quickly coming up, was very much disappointed and fiercely abused the dog. The hound looked up and said, "It was not my fault, master. My spirit was as good as ever, but I could not help my infirmities. I would rather deserve to be praised for what I have been than to be blamed for what I am." The Bee and Jupiter. A bee from Mount Hymettus, the queen of the hive, ascended to Olympus to present Jupiter some honey fresh from her combs. Jupiter, delighted with the offering of honey, promised to give whatever she would ask. She therefore besought him, saying, "Give me, I pray thee, a sting, that if any mortal shall approach to take my honey, I may kill him." Jupiter was much displeased, for he loved the race of man, but could not refuse the request because of his promise. He thus answered the bee, "You shall have your request, but it will be at the peril of your own life. For if you use your sting, it shall remain in the wound you make, and then you will die from the loss of it." Evil wishes, like chickens, come home to roost. The Milkwoman and Her Pail. A farmer's daughter was carrying her pail of milk from the field to the farmhouse when she fell a musing. "The money for which this milk will be sold will buy at least 300 eggs. The eggs, allowing for all mishaps, will produce 250 chickens. The chickens will become ready for the market when poultry will fetch the highest price, so that by the end of the year I shall have money enough for my share to buy a new gown. In this dress I will go to the Christmas parties where all the young fellows will propose to me, but I will toss my head and refuse every one." At this moment she tossed her head in unison with her thoughts, when down fell the milk pail to the ground, and all her imaginary schemes perished in a moment. The Seaside Travelers. Some travelers, journeying along the seashore, climbed to the summit of a tall cliff, and looking over the sea, saw in the distance what they thought was a large ship. They waited in the hope of seeing it enter the harbor, but as the object on which they looked was driven nearer to the shore by the wind, they found that it could at most be a small boat, and not a ship. When, however, it reached the beach, they discovered that it was only a large faggot of sticks, and one of them said to his companions, "We have waited for no purpose, for after all there is nothing to see but a load of wood." Our mere anticipations of life outrun its realities,
The Wolf and the Fox. At one time, a very large and strong wolf was born among the wolves, who exceeded all his fellow wolves in strength, size, and swiftness, so that they unanimously decided to call him Lion. The wolf, with a lack of sense proportioned to his enormous size, thought that they gave him this name in earnest, and leaving his own race, consorted exclusively with the lions. An old sly fox, seeing this, said, "May I never make myself so ridiculous as you do in your pride and self-conceit. For even though you have the size of a lion among wolves, in a herd of lions you are definitely a wolf." The Walnut Tree. A walnut tree standing by the roadside bore an abundant crop of fruit. For the sake of the nuts, the passers-by broke its branches with stones and sticks. The walnut tree piteously exclaimed, "Oh, wretched me! That those whom I cheer with my fruit should repay me with these painful requitals!" The Gnat and the Lion. A gnat came and said to a lion, "I do not in the least fear you, nor are you stronger than I am. For in what does your strength consist? You can scratch with your claws and bite with your teeth on a woman in her quarrels. I repeat that I am altogether more powerful than you, and if you doubt it, let us fight and see who will conquer." The gnat, having sounded his horn, fastened himself upon the lion and stung him on the nostrils and the parts of the face devoid of hair. While trying to crush him, the lion tore himself with his claws until he punished himself severely. The gnat thus prevailed over the lion, and buzzing about in a song of triumph, flew away. But shortly afterwards, he became entangled in the meshes of a cobweb and was eaten by a spider. He greatly lamented his fate, saying, "Woe is me that I, who can wage war successfully with the hugest beasts, should perish myself from this spider, the most inconsiderable of insects." The Monkey and the Dolphin. A sailor bound on a long voyage took with him a monkey to amuse him while on shipboard. As he sailed off the coast of Greece, a violent tempest arose, in which the ship was wrecked, and he, his monkey, and all the crew were obliged to swim for their lives. A dolphin saw the monkey contending with the waves, and supposing him to be a man, whom he is always said to befriend, came and placed himself under him to convey him on his back in safety to the shore. When the dolphin arrived with his burden in sight of land, not far from Athens, he asked the monkey if he were an Athenian. The latter replied that he was, and that he was descended from one of the most noble families in that city. The dolphin then inquired if he knew the Piraeus, the famous harbor of Athens. Supposing that a man was meant, the monkey answered that he knew him very well, and that he was an intimate friend. The dolphin, indignant at these falsehoods, dipped the monkey under the water and drowned him. The Jackdaw and the Doves. A jackdaw, seeing some doves in a cot, abundantly provided with food, painted himself white, and joined them in order to share their plentiful maintenance. The doves, as long as he was silent, supposed him to be one of themselves, and admitted him to their cot. But when one day he forgot himself, and began to chatter, they discovered his true character, and drove him forth, pecking him with their beaks. Failing to obtain food among the doves, he returned to the jackdaws. They, too, not recognizing him on account of his color, expelled him from living with them. So desiring two ends, he obtained neither. The Horse and the Stag. At one time the horse had the plain entirely to himself. Then a stag intruded into his domain and shared his pasture. The horse, desiring to revenge himself on the stranger, asked a man if he were willing to help him in punishing the stag. The man replied that if the horse would receive a bit in his mouth and agree to carry him, he would contrive effective weapons against the stag. The horse consented and allowed the man to mount him. From that hour, he found that instead of obtaining revenge on the stag, he had enslaved himself to the service of man. The Kid and the Wolf. A kid, returning without protection from the pasture, was pursued by a wolf. Seeing he could not escape, he turned around and said, "I know, friend Wolf, that I must be your prey, but before I die, I would ask of you one favor. You will play me a tune to which I may The wolf complied, and while he was piping and the kid was dancing, some hounds, hearing the sound, ran up and began chasing the wolf. Turning to the kid, he said,
"It is just what I deserve, for I, who am only a butcher, should not have turned piper to please you."
The Prophet. A wizard, sitting in the marketplace, was telling the fortunes of the passers-by, when a person ran up in great haste and announced to him that the doors of his house had been broken open and that all his goods were being stolen. He sighed heavily and hastened away as fast as he could run. A neighbor saw him running and said, "Oh, you fellow there, you say you can foretell the fortunes of others. How is it that you did not foresee your own?" The Fox and the Monkey. A fox and a monkey were traveling together on the same road. As they journeyed, they passed through a cemetery full of monuments.
"All these monuments which you see," said the monkey, "are erected in honor of my ancestors, who were in their day freedmen and citizens of great renown."
The fox replied, "You have chosen a most appropriate subject for your falsehoods, as I am sure none of your ancestors will be able to contradict you." A false tale often betrays itself. The Thief and the House Dog. A thief came in the night to break into a house. He brought with him several slices of meat in order to pacify the house dog so that he would not alarm the master by barking. As the thief threw him the pieces of meat, the dog said,
"If you think to stop my mouth, you will be greatly mistaken. This sudden kindness at your hands will only make me more watchful, lest under these unexpected favors to myself, you have some private ends to accomplish for your own benefit and for my master's injury."
The Man, the Horse, the Ox, and the Dog. A horse, ox, and dog, driven to great straits by the cold, sought shelter and protection from man. He received them kindly, lighted a fire, and warmed them. He let the horse make free with his oats, gave the ox an abundance of hay, and fed the dog with meat from his own table. Grateful for these favors, the animals determined to repay him to the best of their ability. For this purpose they divided the term of his life between them, and each endowed one portion of it with the qualities which chiefly characterized himself. The horse chose his earliest years, and gave them his own attributes. Hence every man in his youth, impetuous, headstrong, and obstinate in maintaining his own opinion. The ox took under his patronage the next term of life, and therefore man in his middle age is fond of work, devoted to labor, and resolute to amass wealth and to husband his resources. The end of life was reserved for the dog, wherefore the old man is often snappish, irritable, hard to please, and selfish, tolerant only of his own household, but averse to strangers and to all who do not administer to his comfort or to his necessities. The Apes and the Two Travelers. Two men, one who always spoke the truth and the other who told nothing but lies, were traveling together and by chance came to the land of apes. One of the apes, who had raised himself to be king, commanded them to be seized and brought before him, that he might know what was said of him among men. He ordered at the same time that all the apes be arranged in a long row on his right hand and on his left, and that a throne be placed for him, as was the custom among men. After these preparations, he signified that the two men should be brought before him, and greeted them with this salutation.
"What sort of a king do I seem to you to be, O strangers?"
The lying traveller replied,
"You seem to be a most mighty king."
"And what is your estimate of those you see around me?"
"These," he made answer, "are worthy companions of yourself, fit at least to be ambassadors and leaders of armies."
The ape and all his court, gratified with the lie, commanded that a handsome present be given to the flatterer. On this, the truthful traveller thought to himself,
"If so great a reward be given for a lie, with what gift may not I be rewarded, if, according to my custom, I tell the truth?"
The ape quickly turned to him.
"And pray how do I and these friends around me seem to you?" "Thou art," he said, "a most excellent ape, and all these thy companions after thy example are excellent apes too."
The king of the apes, enraged at hearing these truths, gave him over to the teeth and claws of his companions. The Wolf and the Shepherd. A wolf followed a flock of sheep for a long time, and did not attempt to injure one of them. The shepherd at first stood on his guard against him, as against an enemy, and kept a strict watch over his movements. But when the wolf, day after day, kept in the company of the sheep and did not make the slightest effort to seize them, the shepherd began to look upon him as a guardian of his flock, rather than as a plotter of evil against it. And when occasion called him one day into the city, he left the sheep entirely in his charge. The wolf, now that he had an opportunity, fell upon the sheep and destroyed the greater part of the flock. When the shepherd returned to find his flock destroyed, he exclaimed, "Oh, I have been rightly served. Why did I trust my sheep to a wolf?" The Hares and the Lions. The hares harangued the assembly and argued that they should all be equal. The lions made this reply, "Your words, O hares, are good, but they lack both claws and teeth such as we have." The Lark and Her Young Ones. A lark had made her nest in the early spring on the young green wheat. The brood had almost grown to their full strength, and attained the use of their wings and the full plumage of their feathers, when the owner of the field, looking over his ripe crop, said, "The time has come when I must ask all my neighbors to help me with my harvest." One of the young larks heard his speech and related it to his mother, inquiring of her what place they should move for safety. "There is no occasion to move yet, my son," she replied. "The man who only sends to his friends to help him with his harvest is not really in earnest." The owner of the field came again a few days later and saw the wheat shedding the grain from excess of ripeness. He said, "Oh, I will come myself tomorrow with my laborers and with as many reapers as I can hire, and will get in the harvest." The lark, on hearing these words, said to her brood, "It is time now to be off, my little ones, for the man is in earnest this time. He no longer trusts his friends, but will reap the field himself." Self-help is the best help. The Fox and the Lion. When a fox who had never yet seen a lion fell in with him by chance for the first time in the forest, he was so frightened that he nearly died with fear. On meeting him for the second time, he was still much alarmed, but not to the same extent as at first. On seeing him the third time, he so increased in boldness that he went up to him and commenced a familiar conversation with him. Acquaintance softens prejudices. The Weasel and the Mice. A weasel, inactive from age and infirmities, was not able to catch mice as he once did. He therefore rolled himself in flour and lay down in a dark corner. A mouse, supposing him to be food, leaped upon him and was instantly caught and squeezed to death. Another perished in a similar manner, and then a third, and still others after them. A very old mouse, who had escaped many a trap and snare, observed from a safe distance the trick of his crafty foe, and said, "Ah, you that lie there, may you prosper just in the same proportion as you are what you pretend to be." The Boy Bathing. A boy bathing in a river was in danger of being drowned. He called out to a passing traveler for help, but instead of holding out a helping hand, the man stood by unconcernedly and scolded the boy for his imprudence. "Oh, sir," cried the youth, "pray help me now and scold me afterwards." Counsel without help is useless. The Ass and the Wolf. An ass feeding in a meadow saw a wolf approaching to seize him, and immediately pretended to be lame. The wolf, coming up, inquired the cause of his lameness. The ass replied that, passing through a hedge, he had trod with his foot upon a sharp thorn. He requested that the wolf pull it out, lest when he ate him it should injure his throat. The wolf consented, and lifted up the foot, and was giving his whole mind to the discovery of the thorn, when the ass, with his heels, kicked his teeth into his mouth and galloped away. The wolf, being thus fearfully mauled, said, "Oh, I am rightly served. For why did I attempt the art of healing, when my father only taught me the trade of a butcher?" The Seller of Images. A certain man made a wooden image of Mercury and offered it for sale. When no one appeared willing to buy it, In order to attract purchasers, he cried out that he had the statue to sell of a benefactor who bestowed wealth and helped to heap up riches. One of the bystanders said to him, "My good fellow, why do you sell him? Being such a one as you describe, when you may yourself enjoy the good things he has to give." "Why," he replied, "I am in need of immediate help, and he is wont to give his good gifts very slowly." The Fox and the Grapes. A famished fox saw some clusters of ripe black grapes hanging from a trellised vine. She resorted to all her tricks to get at them, but wearied herself in vain, for she could not reach them. At last she turned away, hiding her disappointment, and saying, "The grapes are sour and not ripe as I thought." The Man and His Wife. A man had a wife who made herself hated by all the members of his household. Wishing to find out if she had the same effect on the persons in her father's house, he made some excuse to send her home on a visit to her father. After a short time she returned, and when he inquired how she had got on, and how the servants had treated her, she replied, "The herdsmen and shepherds cast on me looks of aversion." He said, "Oh, wife, if you were disliked by those who go out early in the morning with their flocks, and return late in the evening, what must have been felt towards you by those with whom you passed the whole day?" The Peacock and Juno. The peacock made complaint to Juno that while the nightingale pleased every ear with his song, he himself no sooner opened his mouth than he became a laughing-stock to all who heard him. The goddess, to console him, said, "But you far excel in beauty and in size. The splendor of the emerald shines in your neck, and you unfold a tail gorgeous with painted plumage." "But for what purpose have I," said the bird, "this dumb beauty, so long as I am surpassed in song?" "The lot of each," replied Juno, "has been assigned by the will of the fates. To thee, beauty. To the eagle, strength. To the nightingale, song. To the raven, favorable. And to the crow, unfavorable auguries. These are all contented with the endowments allotted to them." The Hawk and the Nightingale. A nightingale, sitting aloft upon an oak, and singing according to his wont, was seen by a hawk, who, being in need of food, swooped down and seized him. The nightingale, about to lose his life, earnestly begged the hawk to let him go, saying that he was not big enough to satisfy the hunger of a hawk, who, if he wanted food, ought to pursue the larger birds. The hawk, interrupting him, said, "I should indeed have lost my senses if I should let go food ready in my hand for the sake of pursuing birds which are not yet even within sight." The Dog, the Cock, and the Fox. A dog and a cock, being great friends, agreed to travel together. At nightfall they took shelter in a thick wood. The cock, flying up, perched himself on the branches of a tree, while the dog found a bed beneath in the hollow trunk. When the morning dawned, the cock, as usual, crowed very loudly several times. A fox heard the sound, and wishing to make a breakfast on him, came and stood under the branches, saying how earnestly he desired to make the acquaintance of the owner of so magnificent a voice. The cock, suspecting his civilities, said, "Sir, I wish you would do me the favor of going around to the hollow trunk below me, and waking my porter, so that he may open the door and let you in." When the fox approached the tree, the dog sprang out and caught him and tore him to pieces. The Wolf and the Goat. A wolf saw a goat feeding at the summit of a steep precipice, where he had no chance of reaching her. He called to her and earnestly begged her to come lower down, lest she fall by some mishap, and he added that the meadows lay where he was standing and the herbage was most tender. She replied, "No, my friend, it is not for the pasture that you invite me, but for yourself, who are in want of food." The Lion and the Bull. A lion, greatly desiring to capture a bull, and yet afraid to attack him on account of his great size, resorted to a trick to ensure his destruction. He approached the bull and said, "I have slain a fine sheep, my friend, and if you will come home and partake of him with me, I shall be delighted to have your company." The lion said this in the hope that as the bull was in the act of reclining to eat, he might attack him to advantage, and make his meal on him. The bull, on approaching the lion's den, saw the huge spits and giant cauldrons, and no sign whatever of the sheep, and without saying a word, quietly took his departure. The lion inquired why he went off so abruptly without a word of salutation to his host, who had not given him any cause for offense.
"I have reasons enough," said the bull. "I see no indication whatever of you having slaughtered a sheep, while I do see very plainly every preparation for your dining on a bull."
The Goat and the Ass. A man once kept a goat and an ass. The goat, envying the ass on account of his greater abundance of food, said, "How shamefully you are treated, at one time grinding in the mill, and at another carrying heavy burdens." And he further advised him to pretend to be epileptic and fall into a ditch and so obtain rest. The ass listened to his words and, falling into a ditch, was very much bruised. His master, sending for a leech, asked his advice. He bade him pour upon the wounds the lungs of a goat. They at once killed the goat and so healed the ass. The Town Mouse and the Country Mouse. A country mouse invited a town mouse, an intimate friend, to pay him a visit and partake of his country fare. As they were on the bare ploughlands, eating their wheat stalks and roots pulled up from the hedgerow, the town mouse said to his friend, "You live here with the life of the ants, while in my house is the horn of plenty. I am surrounded by every luxury, and if you will come with me, as I wish you would, you shall have an ample share of my dainties." The country mouse was easily persuaded, and returned to town with his friend. On his arrival, the town mouse placed before him bread, barley, beans, dried figs, honey, raisins, and last of all brought a dainty piece of cheese from a basket. The country mouse, being much delighted at the sight of such good cheer, expressed his satisfaction in warm terms, and lamented his own hard fate. Just as they were beginning to eat, someone opened the door, and they both ran off squeaking as fast as they could to a hole so narrow that two could only find room in it by squeezing. They had scarcely begun their repast again when someone else entered to take something out of a cupboard, whereupon the two mice, more frightened than before, ran away and hid themselves. At last the country mouse, almost famished, said to his friend, "Oh, although you've prepared me for so dainty a feast, I must leave you to enjoy it by yourself. It is surrounded by too many dangers to please me. I prefer my bare ploughlands and roots from the hedgerow, where I can live in safety and without fear." The Wolf, the Fox, and the Ape. A wolf accused a fox of theft, but the fox entirely denied the charge. An ape undertook to adjudge the matter between them. When each had fully stated his case, the ape announced this sentence, "I do not think you, wolf, ever lost what you claim, and I do believe you, fox, to have stolen what you so stoutly deny." The dishonest, if they act honestly, get no credit.